Hello everyone, I welcome you all for today's session on digital system design using Verilog, lecture 3 on module 2, that's about memories. I'm your friend Mahadev S. Khandera, assistant professor, department of ENC, Gausia College of Engineering, Ramanagaram. If you're not subscribed to my channel, subscribe to my channel, click on the bell icon for further notification. First, let us see what we are going to cover today there. So we'll be concentrating on the memory types. So today we will be dealing with the asynchronous static RAM and some of the concepts of the synchronous static RAM. And the third one, what we have in the memory type is multi-port memories, dynamic RAM, and read-only memories. Okay. First, about the memories, we'll understand that. So when we think of the memories, it's a storage device, as we already know. Then when it is a storage device, then it has two simple operations, that is about a read and write, and how it is performing, that is we want to concentrate here. Okay, so here we are distinguishing between the memories that are both read and written, which are called as random access memory. So RAM is what? It performs both read and write. That's why it is called as random access memory. And why it is called, we'll come to know there in the later section. And memory that can only be read, memories that can only be read is called as read-only memory. That is about ROM. Okay. So here we have two different types. One is RAM and ROM. RAM, it performs both read and write. ROM, it performs only the read operation there. So memory in early computers enforce the sequential operations. In the means what? The operations they perform sequentially, one after the other. That is access to the location in increasing order of the address due to the physical medium on which the data was stored. The reason behind that one was how the data was stored on a physical medium that led it to follow the sequential order there. That's from the increasing order fashion. But the invention of the memories in which the location could be read and written with equal facility in any order. So observe the most important terminology what we have here. The invention of the memories because of the silicons. And what has happened is that it can be read and written equally at any order, which was significantly a milestone which was achieved there. So the term is called as RAM. Why it is called random access means it can access any memory location and from there it can follow the order. It is not that it should start from the certain position there. Okay. So the term is called as random access memory. It is randomly accessing the memory. Okay. Now in this we have first topic which we'll be covering is asynchronous static RAM. The word asynchronous itself says that it doesn't depend upon the clock. This is one of the simplest form of memories, that is asynchronous static RAM. It does not rely on the clock, as I just said, asynchronous. It doesn't depend upon the clock there. The term static means that the stored data persists indefinitely so long as power is applied to the memory component. It means what? Till we apply the power supply to the particular memory component, the value is stored. Once the power supply is removed, the value gets lost there. So that's why it is called as volatile RAM. So the static RAM is a volatile, meaning that it requires power to maintain the stored data and loses the data if the power is removed. Okay, so this is volatile in nature. RAM is usually further shortened as SRAM. The static RAM, in the future we call it as SRAM there. So now let us see, asynchronous static RAM internally uses 1-bit storage cells that are similar to the DLAT circuit. So how this asynchronous static RAM similarity is that it is similar to a DLAT circuit. So what happens here is that external interference of asynchronous static RAM is very close to a general description of memory component. That is, asynchronous RAMs are usually only available as packed integrated circuit, not as blocks in ASIC libraries. or FPGA. They usually have bidirectional tri-state data input and output. So if you observe this, what we are just saying is that it is not externally connected. It is available inside the packages of the IC itself. It is not separate packages what we have similarly like an ASIC libraries or a FPGA what we have there. Okay. Next is, let us see one simple example of a asynchronous static RAM. This is a figure shows a symbol of typical asynchronous static RAM where it has address, data, okay, then chip enable, write enable, then output enable there. So if you observe, these are with bubbles here, so it is bar everywhere what you can just note it. So the chip enable input is used to enable or disable the memory chip what we have there. Okay, the write enable input controls whether the memory is enabled to perform the write or read operation depending upon the W E bar signal there. Next we have is output enable input, which controls the tri-state buffer during the read operation. It means what? Once it, output enable is low during a read operation, the drivers are enabled and can drive the read data onto the data pins. So it can perform read operation. If it is high, the output drives to a high impedance state. When it is high, the drivers are in the high impedance state there. So that's the thing what we have with the all three important control signals what we have there. Given that the storage cells are in asynchronous static RAM, are basically latches as we already discussed, it is not surprising that the timing diagram is similar to that of a D-latch. So when we are saying it is a control sequences, how it performs is that it is similar to that of a D-latch, because as we are saying, it is similar to a basic structure of a latches there. Now let us see one of the timing diagrams of a asynchronous static RAM. So here we have taken for a write operation there. Okay, the timing for the write and read operation in the single static RAM. Now we are concentrating on the write operation. So the sequence of signal to perform a write operation is shown in this figure. You can observe here where address is written, chip enable is there, write enable is there, output enable is there, and the data what it is coming. Okay, so what happens if you observe? First, chip enable, because the memory should be active. After chip enable, what happens? The write bar should be active. Once the write bar is active, what happens is that here it is storing the data. Where it is storing the data, if you observe, this rising edge. Before this, it is satisfying the setup time, and after the edge, it is satisfying the hold time there. So the control section that sequence the data path containing the memory must ensure that the address is stable before commencing the write operation and is held stable during the entire operation. As we know, this is the first important criteria that has to be met. Either the address or the data, it has to be stable either before the rising edge or a falling edge, depending upon the signal what we are using there. Okay, so the data and the address must be stable there. So otherwise, the location other than one to be uploaded may be affected. So what happens if the address is not maintained stable? It may be written anywhere else. Okay, so the control section selects the particular memory chip by driving CE low there and activates the write operation by driving WE low and ensures that the chip is in tri-state driver because output enable is high there, because this is low and that is high. So what happens is that it is not read, it is performing the write operation. So it also sets the control signal to provide the data path to provide the data on the data signal. So because of this, what happens is that whatever the data is there, data will be available in the data signal there. Okay. So once the data is stored temporarily in the latch cell for the address location, what it has been specified. So the final data to be stored must be stable on the data signal a setup time before the rising edge of the WE signal or the CE signal, whichever occurs first. So here the control signal what is depending is that either WE should come first or a CE. If anyone which is coming first, but the condition is that the data must be stable there. Okay. If you observe here, the address must be stable, and here in this edge it is, you are observing the data must be stable. So the data in the address must remain stable for a whole time after the WRC signal goes high. Okay, so what happens once it goes high, it should be old. It is showing that the data is stable there, because these are the two important parameters: before rising edge setup, after rising edge hold. If it is stable, whatever the data is receiving at the output, it will be correct data there. Now, since now till now we have just seen the write operation, now let us concentrate on the read operation. When it is read operation, chip enable is same. The only thing is that write enable should be active high. Once the write enable is active high, and the output enable should be active low there. When these two conditions are met, then the data is read. If you observe here, the chip enable is 1, write enable is becoming 0 there. Write enable is becoming 1, it means it is a read operation. Output enable is low. When the output enable is low, what happens is that whatever the data was stored in the memory location, it is read there to the output driver, overcoming from the high impedance state there. So the typical sequence of a signal for a read operation is similar as shown in the figure what we have. The difference is that W is high and the OE signal is down low there. While this sequence is typically for a read operation done in isolation, we can also perform back-to-back read operation simply by changing the address value. So if you want to read the continuous data, you have taken only for a single data. If you want to perform a continuous reading of a memory location, you can perform back-to-back read operation by making the output enable low for the longer duration of time there. Okay. So the read operation is essentially a combinational operation involving decoding the address and multiplexing the selected last cell value onto the output. So as it says that it should decode the addresses what is being given from where the data has to be read. Once it is decoded, that particular value stored in that is multiplexed to the output port. Okay, so the changing the address simply causes the different cell values to appear on the output after a propagation delay. So what happens is that if you want to continuously read, what happens is that it takes a certain delay and performs the read operation there. Okay, that delay which will not affect the design. So this is a simple timing diagram for the read operation what we have there. So this is a combination of both read and write operation of a asynchronous static program. So now here, manufacturer of asynchronous static RAM chip published the timing parameters for write and read operation in a data set. So whatever the SRAM is, that is asynchronous static RAM is manufactured by the manufacturer, they provide the data sheet and this timing parameters, how it is working there. So parameter typically includes setup and hold time for the address and the data value and delay for turning the tri-state driver on and off. So these are the important thing what you have to observe it in a data set of a whatever the RAM what we are using it there from the manufacturer. So one of the figure of merit of a memory chip is its access time, which is the delay from the start of a read operation to having valid data at the output time. So what happens, what is the efficiency, how it is performing, or what is the figure of merit of a memory chip is that its access time. How much delay it takes when it starts the read operation and what is the time to reach it at the output. That's called as access time of a single static RAM. So other performance related parameters are the write cycle time and the read cycle time, which are the time taken to complete the write and read operation respectively. So why we are concentrating is that one is control sequence, other one is a read and write cycle, another is memory access. So different parameters are there. All these parameters has to be met. So these are nothing but the design constraint which has to be met when we are designing any of the model using this particular memory location memories or any other combination circuits or the flip-flop. So manufacturer offers chips in different speed grades, with faster chip usually costing more. Okay, so any manufacturer which they are manufacturing the faster, there's a chip, it depends upon the speed grade there, and some of them will be very fast. Because of this, the cost of that will be more. This allows us as designer to make a cost performance trade-off in our design. So what happens is that the designer, when they are designing it, they will ask the user what kind of a memory design they need, whether they need a fast or a medium or a slow. So depending upon the user requirement, according to the design, they check about the cost per performance ratio there. Okay, so these are the important parameters present in the asynchronous static RAMs. Along with that, what we have is, while asynchronous RAMs are conceptually simple and have a simple timing behavior, the fact they are asynchronous can make them difficult to use in clocked synchronous system. So this is another drawback of asynchronous. Since they are asynchronous mode, it doesn't depend upon the clock. When it doesn't depend upon the clock, what happens? The timing problem may occur when the model is being built. So the before building the model, we have to take care of all these timing parameters and design it. If it is not meeting, then the model entire will not work properly. So the need of to set up and hold address and the data value before and after activation of the control signal, and to keep the value stable during the entire cycle, means that we must either perform operation over a multiple clock cycle or use delay element to ensure the correct timing within a clock cycle. So what is the important thing, how they are maintaining this timing parameters, is that one thing is that either we have to add a delay element in the design, or it should work with the multiple clock cycle systems. Okay, so these are the two important things. If it has to meet the timing constraints of the asynchronous static RAM, so either two of the things it should perform is, one is multiple clock cycle, or another one is we have to add a delay element to ensure that correct timing is maintained within the given clock cycle. Clear? Now, when you're seeing the drawback, now it has to be overcome. That is done with the help of a synchronous static RAM. Even the difficulties associated with asynchronous RAM, many memory components, vendors, and implementation fabrics provide synchronous static RAM, otherwise known as SSRAMs. So to avoid asynchronous static RAM, the manufacturer also started providing the synchronous static RAM. The internal structures of the SRAMs are same as those of asynchronous static RAM. It's similar, but how it operates is a little bit different. So however, the interface include clocked register for storing the address, input data and control values, and in some cases output also. So if you observe, the important thing is there in synchronous, what is happening, it is using the clocked register for storing the address, input data and control signals, and in some cases even it stores the output values also there. So the detail of control signal and timing will vary between SSRAM provided by different component vendors and implementation fabrics. That's by default true, because different manufacturer according to the requirements, what they get it from the user. And it is not necessary that it should have a standard timing parameters for what they are designing. So it will be always different for different vendors when they design the synchronous static RAM there. Okay, so there are two types of synchronous static RAMs. One is flow through SSRAM, second one is pipelined SSRAM. The simplest kind of SSRAM is often called as flow through. Flow through word itself says that if you pass a water inside a pipe, it is just flowing. The same thing here, if you are giving a data to the input, but automatically it goes on to the output there. That's the thing what it is called flow through. So here if you observe, it includes a register on the inputs but not on the data output. So when we are saying it is including at the register, it is storing, and in the output it doesn't have any register, it just pass it out. That's why it is called as flow through. The term flow through refers to the fact that data read from the memory cell flow through directly to the output data. That is the data outputs. So having registers on the input allow us to generate the address, data and control values according to our clock synchronous design methodology. So what happens is that if once the registers is there, then we can sync all the inputs, control signal and the data according to the synchronous timing diagram required for the design method, ensuring that the data is stable before the clock edge. The data is stable before the clock edge by satisfying the setup time, after the clock edge by satisfying the hold time there. So it's stable in time for clock edge. So this is a simple diagram for the flow through what we have it. So if you observe the rising edge of the clock, okay, we have. So in this rising edge, if you observe, enable is zero, doesn't perform any operation. Now enable has become one here, sorry. Enable has become one here. Okay, so what happens? The data is immediately available on the signal when the enable is active. Once the immediate rising edge of the clock is there, then we must assure that the address is stable. So now you can observe it is in the middle, which means that it is satisfying setup time and hold time. So what we have is A1 address. In this A1 address, what is the data present? There is excess. So what happens is that pass it out. So in the immediately the next falling edge, the next address is loaded, but before the next rising edge of the clock, the data, whatever is there in the input, it feeds to the output. Immediately it is passing. You observe it is not at all waiting, it is just passing it. So once the data is passed, it is taking the next memory content, what we have it in the next address location, that is A2. So this is a simple timing diagram, but if you observe when it is performing the operation is right, signal is low. So immediately the right signal becomes low, what we have there. So this is the flow through operation, what we have. Now whatever I explained is explained in terms of sentence there. Now let us see, during the first clock cycle, we set up the address A1, a control signal and the input data access in preparation for the right operation. So in order to perform the right operation, address, data, and the clock is being activated, or any other control signal is there that will be activated. These values are stored in the input register on the next clock edge, causing the SRAM to start the right operation. So in the immediate next rising edge, what it does is that it is asking the SSRAM to perform the right operation. The data is stored and flows through the output during the second clock. So what happens in the second clock when it is happening the rising edge, it just passed the data to the data output there. So it is not waiting because there is no registers to store the operation. So while that happens, we set up the address A2. So when the first data is being transferred, we'll activate the second address, and immediately after the first data is transferred, the second data is also transferred there. Again, these values are stored on the next clock edge, and during the third cycle, it performs the read operation of the second one there. So the data denoted by A2 flow through from the memory to the output. So like this, what happens is now in the third cycle, we set the enable to zero. What is happening here immediately after the two data is read, it is we are making enable zero. Once enable is zero, it will not perform the operation, and the second data is maintained continuously. And that's the reason why we have here continuous value of a second memory location there. So this prevents the input register from being updated on the next clock edge. So the previously read data is maintained at the output as a side. Okay. So in the example, so this is the timing diagram for the flow through SSRAM. Similarly, as we have seen the flow through operation, we have the next concept called as pipelined SSRAM. So this is the second concept of a SSRAM, what we have, it is called as pipelined. So it includes the register on the data output as well as on the input there. So when we have the register at the output, it can store the information and then pass it to the output. Once it is storing, it will ask for the other to wait it there. So a pipelined SSRAM is useful in higher speed system where the access time of the memory is significant proportion of the clock cycle time. So this is the one of the advantages of a pipeline operation, because it syncs with the timing clock cycles of the memory what we have designed. If there is no time in which to perform the combinational operation on the read data before the next clock edge, it needs to be stored in an output register and used in the subsequent clock cycle. So what happens if the combination is not performed in right time its operation, then what we'll do is that we'll store the data at the output register, and in the subsequent clock cycle, will transfer the data to the output cycle there. In this way, we perform the pipelined operation. Let us see the timing diagram of that one. So a pipelined SSRM provides that output registers. Okay, so the timing for the pipeline is illustrated as shown in the figure there. Okay, so the timing for the input is same as that of the flow through, but output little bit changes. The difference is that data output does not reflect the result of a read or write operation until one clock cycle later there. Okay, so immediately after the clock edge, marking the beginning of that particular cycle. So if you observe the difference here, the data was immediately starting because write enable was active and immediately the data was transferred. But what is happening in this rising edge, you have seen the address decode and the data value, but we'll get that at the output after the one clock cycle because in order to sync the operation there. So here first data is received in the when A2 is being decoded, and in the next rising edge the A2 value is being transferred. But enable is zero, the data is getting maintained. So in this two case, the design is different. If you observe here, this much delay, there is a one clock delay what we have it for displaying the result from the data input to the data output. Whereas in the flow through, it was immediate. So this is the difference what we have it in a synchronous, that is flow through synchronous and the synchronous pipelined static RAM there. What we have there is pipelined synchronous static RAM. Okay. If you have any questions, go to the comment section, write down the question, I'll reply to your question. If you like my video, subscribe to my channel and share with your friends. If you like my video, click on the bell icon for further notification. Thank you.